You can listen to the Backward Compatible podcast anytime, anywhere, in any way you like. Subscribe and listen to us on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, or YouTube. Then join the discussion.
So it's a dark and extreme biographical pirate soap opera.
Wait a minute. Didn't they freaking make that?
This week on Backward Compatible, Adam Brackin and Chris Krueger have just launched a Kickstarter. So Jim asks about their new game, genre. Plus, we welcome Doc as the newest member of the Backward Compatible crew and discuss a new direction for the website. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners. This is Jim, and I'm here for our 24th podcast. I'm joined, of course, by Chris Krueger.
Ayo.
And this time we're also joined by Dr. Adam Brackin.
24. Wow, that's kind of impressive.
Yep, 24. We're moving along.
Yep. And of course, Doc's been a guest with us on the podcast before, but today is a special occasion because this is his first podcast as a quote-unquote full crew member of Backward Compatible.
Is it official?
It is official.
Has he gotten his, like, stamp?
I think the fact that we've said it on the podcast makes it official enough.
Oh, okay. So.
What's the quote-unquote for, then? I mean,
I don't know, because, yeah, like, I don't know if any of us are really, like, full members, given that it's all kind of just, like, a side thing. You know, it's not.
I'm a full member.
I mean, we're full members, but we're not, like...
I'm a card-carrying member.
Yeah, we're not full-timers, though.
I actually believe that.
Yeah. I just wrote Backward Compatible member just on a card, like a note card, and just put it in my wallet.
You haven't done that? High five,
yeah.
Well, I'm super happy to be here, so...
Cool.
Thank you very much for using my kitchen table for this purpose. Yeah.
We've been doing it already, we might as well make it official, so... keeps the cost down, at least. So we don't have to rent the kitchen table.
Still getting paid, right?
No.
This is your payment. That index card.
I really should have read that.
The contract that we totally have.
Contract. This is the record right here.
Yes, it is. So we're doing something a little bit different today. We have done this before where we sort of have developer friends on come and talk about the projects they're working on. At one point, Jim and I had a conversation about the master's project that he was working on. And today, Doc and I actually want to talk a little bit about the game that we're working on. It's called Genre, and we are taking it to Kickstarter starting tomorrow.
Woohoo!
And so, actually, Jim doesn't know much about it, so he's going to be kind of playing the role of blind interviewer, asking us things about the game that we might not even think to pitch, because, you know, we've been staring at the same Kickstarter drafts and thunderclaps and all that sort of stuff for the past... you know, like 3-4 weeks at least.
Yeah.
Not counting the game design. So our own sort of view of what's what gets a little bit skewed naturally.
Now, can I stop you here? Because when y'all first mentioned, I saw you post about the thunderclap, and I'd never heard of it before. Want to go ahead and explain to people that haven't heard of it? Maybe
I'm not sure we're qualified. We hadn't heard of thunderclap.
Yeah. Really?
Either. Okay. Yeah. So it's kind of an obscure thing.
It was actually suggested to us by another friend who has done Kickstarter stuff in the past, and I don't know if they actually used thunderclap. I think it was something that they found out about after the fact and kind of regretted not using.
Mm.
The idea is, like Kickstarter, you start a campaign, but it's about ideas. It's about spreading a message instead of selling a product. So you don't actually pledge money, you pledge support. And you have at least a minimum goal of 100 supporters. And essentially, if you reach that goal by the end of your time period, then everyone who's basically signed in with thunderclap, you sign with Facebook, Twitter, or Tumblr. And basically, it acts like an app. So it requests access to your account so that on that day, at that time, at the end of the campaign, everyone who's pledged their support, they all blast out the same message at the same time.
Does anybody actually use Tumblr? I mean, is that...
They do, apparently. I've been told to steer away from it.
A lot of people... No, there's a lot of people that use Tumblr, but for this sort of a purpose, it seems like it doesn't really fit with Twitter and Facebook, because most of... A lot of Tumblr are blog posts. And there's also...
Well, it
depends. It's microblogging, isn't it?
Kind of, yeah.
It's microblogging?
More and more like microblogging.
Yeah, and unfortunately, there are quite a few... we'll just say passionate people on Tumblr, but they tend to be very passionate. to use a good term, a nice term, which is fine. It's good. Yeah, that's good. But sometimes they get a little too passionate. But hey, for a product like this or any sort of, you know, genre or any sort of, you know, a game idea that you have, if they're passionate about it, that is good.
So. Yeah, ultimately, the Thunderclap is about, like, having a really big social reach. We'll actually track, in addition to the number of supporters, what their social reach is based on, you know, the size of their network that they sign in with. So rather than basically trying to spread the word manually, if you will, and having, like, people say, you know, post this hashtag or talk about this and, you know, sort of things, you'll see on Twitter, like, you know, currently trending, Facebook currently trending. I don't know, maybe you guys don't use it that often. But there can be these weird looks like, thanks, trend?
No, I think Doc was watching me try to slowly open this bottle.
Just open the bottle.
Yeah, it was a subtle Coke opening right
yeah.
there.
Okay. It was really, really lightly hissing out as I was trying not to make any noise.
But the idea is that basically you have a whole bunch of people saying the same thing at the same time, which... you know, can blast or can sort of raise awareness of a thing very quickly if it's successful. That being said, I've never seen one before, maybe just because the people in my networks don't use Thunderclap.
But how do you know you didn't see it? Because then it just tweet out a message, like, promoting whatever it is that they're promoting.
I think what would happen is, say, on Facebook, it would say so-and-so posted via Thunderclap, and then it has their automated message, and there's also a link, which is a shortened, like, thndr.it link. With, like, you know, sort of like a shortened URL that you click on to take you to whatever website they want you to see. So whether it's, like, you know, it's used, again, for more than just crowdfunding. Crowdfunding is one application for it. People also use it for, like, you know, political stuff, to promote a book, to promote a new album, all sorts of different stuff like that.
Okay. Well, it's a lot of Thunderclap talk.
Yes.
But,
well, you know, we've been kind of happy with it because we've apparently got a 30,000 person reach right now, so
that's good.
Yeah,
that is good.
Who knows, maybe even more by the time it goes out. But
yeah, no, it is, it does sound pretty cool. I mean, the concept of it is pretty neat. I just hadn't heard of it before. But okay, well, hopefully it'll work out. I mean, we'll see. I'm on there, I'm up for Thunderclap, so by the time this goes out, I don't think it'll be a thing anymore. The Thunderclap will already have gone out by the time this podcast goes out. But the Kickstarter will just be getting started.
Yes.
Once this goes out.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
And that's what we're going to be talking about today.
Yes.
Is genre.
And if you don't know how to spell genre, that's G-E-N-R-E, by the way. Just if you're like me and had to look it up the first time.
It's not like the name John followed by Ra.
No.
Okay.
No, although that gives me an idea for a second game.
It's like the syncretic connection between, you've got John and then, you know, the sun god.
Yeah.
Okay. It's like his great 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 grandson.
Right,
it's John Ra. Yeah,
John Ra. Yeah. Possibly a Mum Ra connection in there somewhere as well.
That might have been an episode of SG-1. We'll have to check. I'm not sure.
Could have been.
Is that too obscure? Is it?
No. That's right up around.
Am I too old to make that joke?
I think we're leading into genre with that.
We are, in fact. So there we go. That's a perfect segue, and I know I did it on purpose because. We have, this interesting icebreaker that's going to in no way at all explain the mechanics of the game, but rather describe the characteristics of the card.
Okay.
So, we haven't really been advertising it, if you will, on our pages, but one of the secondary sort of uses for genre, in addition to the game itself, is that we have these little scenario generators. We also have, you know, these cards themselves are listed with a particular genre of fiction. And so you can combine them together to sort of act as a, you know, role-playing campaign scenario generator. Now, if you just want to do a quick one-shot, or if you're just looking to spice up your campaign a little bit, it can be kind of a interesting brain starter. We were going to go ahead and draw randomly from our 102 different genre cards and sort of see what do these combinations remind you of, if anything.
So I'm a little bit nervous because, I mean, we got, like, some meta stuff and the promo stuff.
Mm-hmm.
This could go terribly wrong or terribly right.
So my thought was that we'd start off with two and we'd kind of work our way up to three and then to four. And if we want to get really crazy, depending on time, we might go to five genres and see what a five genre crossover looks like.
That's crazy, man.
And these are genre from, you know, any sort of medium, because
yes.
I know that, for example, in video games, genre tends to refer to gameplay, whereas in, you know, film, it tends to refer to narrative.
Yeah, we're generally talking about narrative genres of fiction, so fantasy, science fiction, drama, tragedy. kids, family, on and on and on.
Now, where do you fall on the scale? Is superhero a genre, in your opinion?
We have a superhero card, so yes.
I was curious. Yeah. Some people say it's not. Mm-hmm. So some people say
they sort of say it's just like a reskin of action or something like that.
Well, there's some people that say that science fiction is really just fantasy. So. Mm.
Well, I'm definitely not one of those people.
Ah, why not?
No, we actually have a hard sci-fi card, which is different from science fiction. And then we also have a hero card, which is different from superheroes.
So. Do you have low fantasy as well as the high fantasy? Or you just have fantasy?
No, but you're given a sneak peek into what we're lovingly and tentatively titling subgenre right now.
Okay.
Which is... possibility of one of our expansions, so maybe we can talk about how that would work. If while I shuffle here, if we reach all our funding goals, you know, we have some mystery goals right now, so maybe we can release one of those as an Easter egg in this podcast. I don't know.
Maybe. We'll see. Of course, everything is tentative right now.
Well, that's
as you
very
said.
True, yeah.
As you said. So.
Okay, I think I've successfully shuffled these badly. So let's.
We're working right now with our two pieces of paper and a plastic sleeve print of the game,
yes.
Our prototype, because we have not printed on actual cards yet.
It's glorious.
It is quite glorious.
I really do like that. I've done that setup before for certain projects when I was in graduate school for prototypes, and it actually works really well.
Yeah,
using a little, like, just paper inside the little card protectors works.
I mean, I see people who go and they'll do an $80 run at, I don't know, you know, Kinko's or something, and I'm like, why?
Oh, for the card stock?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is card stock, but I mean, it's like, I got it at Target.
It's not like, you know, glossy or anything
like
that.
No, it's just...
It's just stick in your printer, hit print.
Yeah. So. All right, so do you want me to read these or hand them to Jim? Or?
Let's go in and draw two and just announce what they are and
okay.
Go from there.
Yeah, we can just go around the table and announce what
so
we have.
So there's one.
I may not know what it means.
But. There's another.
Okay. Are we each getting two? Or should we? Should I go ahead and read mine
like
first?
That. Yeah, let's do that.
We each get two? All right.
Yeah. All right, or is that what we're doing?
There's.
I assume that's what we were doing.
Two at random, and here's another. Okay.
All right, so we've passed out two cards. Okay, so... I'm going to look over my cards here. So I've got the first one here just says art, murder your darlings. Now it's got a D10. I assume that's a D10 dice.
Yes, that is a die.
Okay.
Yep.
So explain to me, I have primary, secondary, and motivation and scene. So what is the difference for these? I can go through and I can read each one, what it says, but I'd like to know what they mean first.
So the primary ability is kind of your basic attack, if you will. We'll get into the way the game works more in depth here in a little while. But essentially, you can either attack the nemesis that you're up against, or you can try to take on these challenge conditions. So the primary ability, like we call it an attack primarily, but it's also able to be used for challenge conditions, basically the sort of action happening outside of the fight, if you will. And it's always going to be a dice value. The goal is always to roll 10 or more in order to succeed either with your attack or at the action you're trying to perform aside from attacking. So for example, you know, on mine, I've got my primary ability on vampire here is bite. So that tends to sort of fit in with the genre, you know, kind of what is the standard way of attacking or hurting something in that genre. And it's the D12, so it's got a decent chance, well, actually not a decent chance, a very low chance of hitting a 10 or above on a single roll, but it's actually a good dice to combine with other cards, other assists, in order to get further. The secondary ability tends to be more of a special ability. It sometimes acts as an attack, sometimes it acts as something that can help another player, and sometimes it does entirely different sort of support type abilities. And then your motivation is going to be something that you can do with this card in order to gain experience. And that's always going to be unique to the card that you're using.
Okay. And you can just reuse your motivation. You can use these. It's not like you burn the card.
Yeah, generally it's once per scene because you exhaust the card after you use it. Basically just turn it sideways. And then you refresh all your cards at the end of each scene.
Okay. So, for us now, we're not playing the full game, though. We're using these cards to build a story.
Essentially, like, you know, build a story or, like, build a character or see if it reminds you of something that exists in real life. So you've got time travel and art, I can
yes,
see.
Yes, my other one is time travel. with Doctor Who. It's the image. But it's time travel is a pretty broad
placeholder image.
Yeah, that would be a placeholder.
Placeholder.
Yeah.
Placeholder image. Thank you. Okay, so...
Well, internal use only will not appear in the final game.
Yes. Yeah, we can't tell you which doctor. And not to be confused
doctor
with a which doctor.
No.
No.
We made that joke in our Kickstarter video.
Yes, we did.
Yeah.
So. Expertly delivered by the guy who delivered that joke. Mm-hmm. I think that was well done. So I guess if you were choosing your characters, whenever you start, you actually start in the traditional game, in the four-player game, with two cards. And if you're playing with four, then one player would be the GM, the genre master, and the other three would be a cooperative team of adventurers. And so you would have two cards, and you would have to name your character and describe your character in general mechanics. And so you would be the art time traveler, or the time traveling artist. And you might come up with a name for yourself and say, you know, I'm that guy from that episode of the show we were just talking about where didn't they go get Van Gogh and bring him like into the future so he could see himself, his own stuff in their episode where they did that?
I've actually like seen all of two episodes of that show.
I'm trying to think that I think towards the end they bring him to the future to show him his stuff in the museum.
Yeah, because he's all depressed and emo and stuff.
Yeah. And he's still depressed at the end.
He still dies.
It's actually a very sad episode.
It really
it's probably
is.
The best one of all the new Who.
Oh, really? Oh, I don't want to get into that debate.
I really like that episode. You not really?
Well,
like
I liked it. I'm just saying Blink is better.
Next time on Backward Compatible.
I think my issue with Blink is I've seen it so many times that I guess it kind of loses some
of
that.
That's fair.
Especially because later on they sort of...
They messed up the
rules. And part of it that got me too is that I watched them out of order. I saw all of the Matt Smith stuff first.
Oh.
That was my first introduction to Doctor Who, the new Doctor Who. And then I went back and watched the rest starting from you know, the Eccleston stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so by the time that I saw the Smith stuff, I had already seen some of the, what are they, the angels, is that?
Yeah, the angels.
Yeah.
The Weeping Angels,
right. Yeah. So I'd already seen some of them, and then, so when I went back and saw Blink, it didn't have that same sort of effect with the rules. I kind of already sort
that
of
makes
thought
sense.
That they were.
Sure.
But I can totally see, I totally understand why initially it was really, really well done.
Yeah. Well, especially since he is not in that episode, but just for a couple minutes. He only has a couple lines.
Yeah, no, that was a really cool touch.
Okay, so your character's been established then. You're time-traveling Van Gogh or something like that?
Sure. I am time-traveling Van Gogh. Or actually, no, I'll be time-traveling Picasso.
Oh, nice.
And we can just assume that, you know, I've got, like, you know, my proportions and my face are not really set up correctly.
Okay. It's a side effect of the time travel.
It's a side effect of the time travel. My I have actually... We can do that. My face and all my characteristics are side effects are, like... They're part of me, but they're from different time periods.
Mm.
So, like, you know, I've got, you know, maybe I've got like a baby arm, you know, and I've got like, you know, I've got one of my ears is just like a normal, you know, like, you know, normal ear, and the other one is like a, you know, 75-year-old grandpa ear, and it's kind of all, you know,
nice.
Got a lot of white hair on it and coming off, and,
yeah.
You know, maybe I've got a really full, long Gandalf-style beard because I've been growing it for so long, but not really, but because of time travel, it just took that long to grow, that kind of thing.
They don't assume shaving when you have that time warp there, you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
There you go.
Cool.
So, yeah. So, I'm not kind of this weird hodgepodge-looking thing.
And all of a sudden,
it could change. It could change at any time because of time travel. See, I could change the aspects of my body parts.
Gotcha.
Well, you're being joined by a melodrama ninja, because that's me.
Okay.
And I'm not entirely sure what a melodrama ninja is. But
that's
thinking
like every ninja, right?
Yeah, I'm thinking like Jack Black as a ninja. Though he did Kung Fu Panda, didn't he?
Yes.
So actually, maybe that's where I'm getting that from. So I'm kind of like
Chris Farley was a ninja.
Oh, he was, wasn't he? He was like what was that movie called?
Beverly Hills Ninja. And it
Beverly
was actually
Hills.
A good movie.
That's me. Okay, I am Beverly Hills Ninja. And one of my primary attack is in fact overacting.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah, so there you go. And my secondary attack is protracted death scene. So if you know, if you don't like my character too much, it's okay because I can have a death scene, and actually it works out really well. So there we go.
Oh.
This is one of the promo cards actually, which is funny because it reads, if this is this character's last card, exhaust it to draw another card from the deck. And so you actually finish your yourself off, and then you don't actually die. You can actually just use it.
Oh.
So some of the funky mechanics are in the really interesting ones that unlock at, let's see, what is that, stretch goal 3 or something? It's after both decks are unlocked.
Right, yeah. So. It's the...
Actually, it's the fourth one, now that I think about
it. It's the Kickstarter edition.
Right.
Yeah. I forget what the amount was on that one.
Well, I should also mention my abilities, too, since I think I did not. Or at least I didn't mention both of them. So, my artist has Avant-Garde, which I'm not sure specifically what this is meant to do. Well, I guess I'll find that out as we go through the game. It says, add any two dice of different types that are not currently being used to whoever I'm assisting. So this is like a good assist type ability, I assume.
Mm-hmm.
And then time travel, I've got flashback. So restore one card from the discard area. All characters. That's good.
Cool. Yeah. And it's worth mentioning too that a lot of times the names of these abilities are kind of left somewhat vague. We don't like try to over-explain everything because we kind of like the idea that you can interpret it in a number of different ways.
Okay.
So when we were writing them, we had in our own head I imagine, like, you know, when I call it this, I imagine this thing happening, and it's either really cool or really funny in my own mind. But someone else might interpret it a different way, or they might find some clever way where it's like, oh, I'm going to use this thing, because you can use any ability to do anything in the game, essentially, if you can explain it properly.
Okay.
And so sometimes hearing those weird explanations that people come with is half the fun.
Like, I can flash back my limbs and my facial features for some reason.
Exactly.
And my beard.
It's a little thing I like to call roleplay.
And then so my abilities, I've got, I'm not sure if I want to be vampire mecha or mecha vampire.
Oh, you got to be mecha vampire.
Mecha vampire?
Yeah.
So that is a mecha that feasts on the energy of other mecha, I suppose.
Yeah.
Which actually doesn't sound that far off. It's just basically just like some sort of
they've drain. Done that in Gundam.
Yeah.
Do you still fight? Some of the Gundam series, yeah.
Is that true?
If you're called a vampire, you kind of need to... Well, no, because there's the concept of vampirism,
yeah,
which doesn't require biting necessarily.
Especially if you're like any sort of like energy vampire is just sort of absorbing energy from other people.
Or any things. Fantasy weapon that has of vampirism in the title.
Yeah. And actually, Mecha is inspired by a giant robot. Sort of stuff, robot anime in particular. Mm-hmm. So, in my own mind, Mecha is Gundam. So, we'll go with something along those lines. But my abilities on Mecha are pilot and autopilot. And then the motivation for Mecha is say hello to my massive friend. Basically, you get an experience if you use autopilot to assist yourself. So it's basically you plus your giant robot attacking somebody. So that's kind of cool. And then with Vampire, I've got Bite and Vampirism. Discard one of an ally's cards to restore in this character's own. Basically, I can drain health from an ally in order to heal myself, which they generally don't like, but sometimes for the good of the team, you gotta kind of work things out.
For the good of the team, they need to suck it up and let you do it.
No pun intended, I'm sure.
What? Oh, that's suck it out.
Oh, okay. And then motivation, Children of the Night, use vampirism to bring an ally down to one health. If I bring someone down to the verge of death, I get an experience for that. So it makes it that much more obnoxious for fellow players.
Woo-hoo.
Yay.
All right, so are we ready for three cards?
Yep.
Three card madness here.
So do we want to add to this or just want to sort of toss these aside and get three new
fresh ones? No, let's toss those aside because we can do the cool thing where we can generate a scene.
Okay, cool.
If we have three cards.
Cool.
So let's see. Here are your three cards.
Okay.
And here are yours.
Thank you.
And then I'll grab three. And here, I'll go first this time so to kind of explain how it works. Because at the bottom of every card, for the genre master, the GM, is three little sections. And the first is an adjective or a description. And then the second is a location. And then the third is 1 to 3 challenge conditions, depending on if it's a level 1, level 2, or level 3 card. So, pulling mine in the same order that I pulled them from the deck, this is a litigious crime scene where you have to accept the inevitable despite your best efforts. Now, that's just a level 1 card at the end there. That's a single challenge condition. But litigious is off of my legal card. Crime scene is off of my cop card. And where you have to accept the inevitable despite your best efforts is off of the tragedy card. So this is a legal cop tragedy, which I feel like I've seen.
Yeah.
any episode of Law and Order, maybe?
Yeah.
Or that terrible SVU show. Oh, God.
Which we did not end up getting into on the podcast, but we were planning on at one point.
Nah, SVU is never really worth watching, aside from making fun of it.
All right.
That's like the dark place of television, in my opinion. I don't know.
Well, it does have...
Excluding anything by, you know, HBO.
It's Ice... Is it Ice Cube or Ice Tea? It's Ice Cube, right?
I think it's Ice Tea, actually.
Is it Ice Tea?
Because Ice Cube's the one in the Coors Light commercials. What they are known for now.
So Ice Tea, whichever one of the ices on there is pretty hilarious.
Speaking of ices,
he's just so completely oblivious to the world around him. It's just hilarious. He's been on that show for like 10-15 years now.
Really?
And he still seems
really?
Like a rookie cop.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, he's been on that show for at least since 2005, if not more.
Huh.
For a long
maybe
time.
Maybe time's compressed and it's still only the first year. It's like we're doing every case he did.
I don't know, maybe, but it just he comes across like every single, because I watched some episodes in addition to the gamer one, and just he always has the same sort of attitude. Like he's just oblivious. Like, whoa, really? Like people are like dying, and like this person did what sort of crime? And you're like, dude, you're in the special victims unit.
Well, someone's got to play the role of the person who's the audience, basically, and asking the questions on behalf of the audience.
The veteran cop shouldn't be that guy.
Yeah, true.
Because then it just makes him seem like an idiot.
Right. Well, mine, I've got a scientifically plausible downtown street where you have to crack a contextually appropriate joke. And the genre here is hard sci-fi action comedy.
Yeah.
Which I'm sure exists somewhere. I'm trying to think of what that might be. But
wait, so you said it's hard sci-fi.
Hard sci-fi
action comedy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's Ascension, but not intentionally.
Shots fired. Ooh.
Ooh. It's hard to say, yeah, because it depends. I don't know. I'm not sure. When you add an action comedy and hard sci-fi, that's pretty tough. I can think of plenty of sci-fi action comedy.
And this actually happened to work out nicely, the order here. Something I like to do as a player is I like to take my cards and reorder them in such a way that sounds like it could be an actual genre. So rather than having, for instance, like, you know, comedy, action, hard sci-fi, it's hard sci-fi action comedy. Something like you'd hear them sort of tell you what the genre of the movie is at the trailer or something.
And as
like
a player,
that.
You can totally do that, but as the GM, you
can't. As the GM, you have to stick to the order, because the order
so
is
it generates
important.
The scene. Though that is one of the variants that we wrote into the rules.
So you can
choose
the GM
can choose the...
Hmm.
Well, I'm going to try here. So here's what I've got. So mine is, I think I'm doing this correctly, an awkward but endearing ocean.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, an awkward but endearing ocean where you have to turn your circumstances into a song. And that's a buddy nautical musical.
Yeah.
Nice.
I think a lot of those exist already, actually. At least in film, if not on stage. So.
Oh, yeah. On stage, I'm thinking for sure.
Yeah.
Just any 1960s musicals, really.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, very nice. All right, so do you want to step up to 4 cards?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right.
All right, here we go.
And we'll take the first 3 and make the scenarios again.
Okay. We're big leagues. So you want to explain what you do with the 4th card if you are the genre master and you get handed 4 cards?
Yeah, so basically what ends up happening is each player at the beginning of a new scene has to hand the genre master 1 card. And that's what generates the character. So because they're always, except in the 2 and 3 player variants, which we, it's a little bit different, but in the sort of standard 4 to 6 player version of the game, you've got 1 genre master and 3 players. And so when they each give the genre master 1 card, you get a 3 card nemesis. And whenever you attack someone, if you deal damage, they have to discard 1 of their cards. So basically each card is also HP. If you have 5 or 6 players, though, counting the GM, what will happen is they give the GM 1 card each. They take the first 3 to generate what the character is, and then the extra 2 cards you just turn upside down, and those become extra HP that you have to get through before you can start damaging the cards with abilities on them. So it's kind of a nice, elegant way of making the nemesis a little bit more powerful with more players without having to sort of like restructure the way the rules work. So,
but Chris, genre is a 4-player game. How can one play 5 or 6 players with a simple deck?
by getting at least two decks of 30 and combining them. The idea is that you have a 30-card deck, which is enough cards to support a four-player game counting the GM. As soon as you have more players, you have to add essentially 10 extra cards to the deck to sort of, you know, work with the balance and the length of the game, all that sort of stuff. So a five-player game counts to the GM, four regular players is 40 cards, five regular players is 50 cards. That's kind of the recommended maximum size. Technically, you can go above and beyond, but it gets really messy that way. It's really hard to coordinate with everyone. So we recommend capping it at six, counting the GM. You would have to get at least two sets of 30 to make that happen.
But Chris, if I order two sets of 30 from the pop deck, which is available, genre pop, on the Kickstarter, which is live now, what will happen whenever the second deck type is unlocked, which I believe is called genre life?
Consumer.
I don't know who said that.
When you order two or more decks as your backer reward, we give you the option once we unlock new decks to choose which ones you want. So if you ordered two from the get-go and we don't unlock the second deck, you get two copies of the first one. But if we do unlock the second, then you can choose, I mean, you can still choose both of one, but like two of the same thing, or you can choose one of each. And yes, that continues on. And so if you get three copies and we unlock three decks, you can choose one of each of the three.
That was very forward-thinking of us.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. So what you're saying is everybody should really just place at the $45 level and get all three decks.
That'd be great if they did. But that is, of course, up to them.
Okay, so moving on from that really well done commercial, it didn't feel fake at all.
Who
wants to go first on the four card?
I do not have my cards yet.
Oh, I thought
you gave me the discard pile.
Did I?
Yes. Or at least a discard pile.
Oh, yeah, I gave you, like, a big stack of them for no reason at all. All
right.
I don't know. Whatever. So,
do you want to go first, Chris?
Give me 1 second to shuffle up. All right, so I've got, and I'm drawing basically just the top three of my four. A totally normal galaxy where you have to make a bully stop picking on you by outsmarting them. And then I can earn one bonus XP just for me if I take an extra action to get my crush to notice me and win their heart.
Oh.
So that is realism space opera geek. Or I would probably reorder if I was a player to geek space opera realism, perhaps.
So basically you're going to a convention.
Perhaps, yes.
Dressed in...
There you go. I'm just a geek cosplaying as a Star Wars character.
You're cosplaying as a Star Wars character.
Yeah.
It's a realistic space opera, so that's like Legend of the Galactic Heroes.
Maybe?
Or is that too obscure?
You're too smart for us.
And then my fourth card, Adventure. So it is the cosplaying geek at the science fiction convention who is on an adventure.
Oh. Mm, nice. Very meta. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, that's a different card.
Yes.
So the first three, you're doing that's your actual genre?
That would be the nemesis, essentially. But then, you know, just for the sake of this game, I'm seeing what it would be if we had all four of the cards put together. So if it was just the nemesis, that would be the first three plus this one I flip over. That's basically just extra HP. So it would be realism, space opera, geek. And then...
If he was the GM.
Right. Yes,
if I was the GM. Well, what are you doing? What are we doing now? Those are your genre.
Yeah, we're generating the scenario with the first three,
okay,
and then sort of saying what we are with all four.
Okay.
Because it gets increasingly complicated the more cards we add to try to actually find something in pop culture that that references.
So I'm gonna try this then. Let me see. So I can just I do my first three, mm-hmm, and that's the actual scene, like I did, like we did the previous one, right?
Correct. Yes.
And then so I'll do those first then.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is a contemporary. This is a contemporary hospital where you have to determine who's actually a werewolf and hunt them down.
So it's like Grey's Anatomy with werewolves?
Yes. And so it's a contemporary medical werewolf show.
Nice.
It
might do well, actually.
Yeah, I think it would actually do very well.
Does Teen Wolf just have like a character who works at a hospital? Because that could be it.
There you go.
Well, the new iZombie show, which is based on the comic, is actually she works in a morgue, but it's kind of similar. She's a zombie that works in a morgue, so she can get easy access to brains, and it's like a mixture of a detective.
Are they fresh brains? Because I didn't think that they did that.
Mm-mm, corpses.
Well, that I don't know. That's a little genre breaking to me.
Well, she's trying not to be a full zombie.
Like the vampires will drink cow's blood.
Yeah, she's like a zombie that's trying not to be a zombie. kind of like, yeah, like Chris said, it's like in vampire shows where they're trying not to kill people, so they drink, like, they go to a hospital and get blood.
Is she like a half zombie? Is there some kind of medication that pushes back the urge or something?
The only way to push back the urge is deep brains.
Oh.
So the idea is that she has to have a constant supply, which is why she quit her med school job in order to go work in a morgue so she can have a constant supply of brains. Okay. It makes sense.
Yeah, because I would totally let Grandpa go down to that morgue and have his brain eaten by a zombie.
Well, Grandpa's dead. He doesn't need his brain anymore.
Of course, nobody finds out about this.
Yeah, of course.
How silly of me.
Okay, so my additional card. Now, my additional card, what does it do for this scenario?
Basically, it doesn't do anything for the scenario, but it will kind of determine what your character would be if you were a player as opposed to the GM. So the GM would generate that scenario like that.
So the GM generates, this is like the scene that I put together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the character in the scene...
And this is we're not playing it like the actual game right now.
We're trying to generate scenes. So then the character is automotive. Mm-hmm. So how does that work?
So you combine all four cards. So what has contemporary medical werewolf and automotive in it? Again, it might just come back to Teen Wolf. I don't know. I've never seen the show, but
you've seen the movie with Michael J. Fox, right?
I have not.
Actually, that's more like Teen Wolf too. Yeah. T-O-O.
Oh yeah,
came Teen out Wolf like 5 years later.
Yeah.
It was terrible.
It was very terrible. Yeah. The original Teen Wolf was good. Sort of.
Yeah, I mean, you know.
So, I don't know. So, I guess the automotive part, like, maybe it's a, like, a rolling hospital where they, like, a traveling hospital where they
it's hunt a,
werewolves.
It's a werewolf whose day job is to be an ambulance driver.
Ambulance driver, yeah.
There we go. Okay, yeah.
And he really hopes that he doesn't have to do the night shift on a full moon.
Right. So. All right, mine's going to be a little tricky here. Because I am a Victorian cartoon spy hero. So the scenario here would be a prim and proper cartoon land where you have to meet a contact at a ritzy bar, infiltrate a high security compound, and foil a plot for world domination. How many cartoon spy heroes are there? I mean, much less in Victorian era.
Yeah, the Victorian
cartoon spy heroes, right?
Yeah.
Totally spies, come on.
Well, I was sort of
kidding with that one, but...
I was Inspector Gadget?
Oh, yeah. Ooh, that's
not
bad. I
mean, that's one of the most common ones, famous ones, right?
Well, I was going to go with Archer until the Victorian.
Mm. Yeah, Archer...
Not exactly
Archer,
family friendly, but...
Archer is a spy hero. Definitely
and he's
Victorian.
A cartoon, I mean.
Yeah, cartoon spy hero.
So...
Inspector Gadget's not Victorian. The Victorian part definitely
is what throws
it off.
That's tricky, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. How many Victorian cartoons have there been? I mean,
well, hold on. Actually, there was a Sherlock Holmes, like mixed with steampunk in a Victorian era cartoon back in like the late 90s. I want to say.
Oh, really?
Saying. Yeah,
I'm remembering something that had Abraham Lincoln and a clockwork robot. Buddy,
That combination sounds familiar. I have no idea what about it.
It was a comic. So
Abraham
I'm going to go with that.
Abraham Lincoln and a clockwork robot?
Yeah, yeah. So I'm going to go with the Abraham Lincoln aspect of that.
Okay.
Abraham Lincoln, cartoon spy hero. And that's me.
So it's like Abraham Lincoln, vampire hunter, except now he's a super spy?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. In fact, I think according to that, which I know, I must have read it, but according to that world, he founded the FBI or something like long before it was actually founded by Wilson.
Fun. All right. So shall we go on and move on to the final five?
Yes,
card
the
round?
Final round here of trying to find popular culture that fits our randomly generated scenario of,
or if not finding popular culture, just making something awesome up. It's half the fun.
All right, Jim. There's five.
Thank you.
Five for Chris there. And five for my cat, which is joining us here tonight.
Okay.
As seen in our promo video.
Shall I go first?
Go for it.
All right. So I'm going to do the three-part scene first, and I'll try to make your character out of the five. So we find ourselves in a musty playhouse where you have to teach the kids a valuable lesson about life. That is magic, Shakespearean family. Which sounds like you take some sort of Shakespearean play and then sort of like make it family friendly and add magic to it. Possibly some sort of Disney adaptation. I don't know. actually, you gave me six cards. I'll let you pull one randomly for me.
Not bad.
All right. And then my other two cards are celebrity and independent. So it's an independent film that features a celebrity. Probably like one of the director's friends that decided to like didn't have a project going on, so decided to help out with this thing. Maybe he's like a
it's like the Knights of Badass Doom,
yeah. The sort of like the narrator, like some like you know voiceover talent to go along with all the other stuff because they couldn't afford any FaceTime. They just had to right. make the voice. So independent celebrity magic Shakespearean family. Very interesting combo.
You're basically Patrick Stewart.
We'll go with that.
I mean, just not even any. Just you're just Patrick Stewart.
Okay,
gotcha. As himself.
As himself. Okay.
Yeah, with that combo.
Cool.
Go for it, Joe.
Cool. Okay, so let me see here. So I got some interesting choices here. So this is an over the top high seas where you have to pick a bone with someone. So this is an extreme pirate soap opera, which I would watch this, actually.
Yeah, actually I would watch
an extreme pirate soap opera. And for the character, the thing... So does this modify the scene, or just the character?
Well, that is the scene.
So that's the scene. And then going to make a character with all five. Again, this is just like kind of
for fun. Our character in this extreme pirate soap opera would have to be based on a pirate that is a biographical figure. So okay. It's all about him.
So Blackbeard or something like that.
Figure, yes. I think we can go with Blackbeard, and he's also dark. So there you go.
There you go.
Dark figure. Sure. Blackbeard.
So it's a dark and extreme biographical pirate soap opera.
Wait a minute. Didn't they freaking make that? Seriously, it's all, like that. That there's like some pirate show called like Black sort of... Sails or High. Or what was that? Like High. I see a few people talking about it. Didn't really interest me, actually. Which is,
I'll take out my cartoon.
I think it's missing the dark water. I think it's missing the extreme part. I'm still mad that show never ended.
Pirates of Dark Water.
Yeah, remember it had that like it had that one season and then.
Actually, I'm totally lying right now. I've never seen it.
You've never seen, but
I know. No,
I really got into it.
I outed myself with that comment.
Cool. So what do you got, Doc?
All right. Well, I actually pulled, I can believe it or not, here Anime School Day Magical Girl. So it is a stylized high school where you have to make up an excuse to your best friend for why you can't make it, deal with a threat they can't know about, and make it back in time to surprise them. And then my two additional cards are surreal and anthropomorphic. So I'm actually a surreal anthropomorphic Anime School Days Magical Girl. And I know nothing about magical girl fiction to know whether or not there are any that are in fact anthropomorphic.
Probably. I don't know any off the top of my head, but
yeah. I mean if I'm thinking of God, I can't believe I forgot the name of that show. It was a really recent show by Gainax.
Kill la Kill?
Yes. Where she's got the suit.
Oh, yeah,
anthropomorphic suit that she wears.
She's
a magical girl with an anthropomorphic suit.
Sweet.
Actually, it talks to her and like it needs to drink blood.
Magical girl is a very...
She is a magical girl.
Very, very
up.
Technically speaking, yes, yeah. But it's nothing like...
Well, the show is meant as a parody of
what you're saying
girl.
Is it's surreal.
So, yeah,
it is
go.
A completely surreal show.
Parody's a different girl.
We just drew Kill la Kill.
Okay, cool.
Awesome.
I'm all over. I have no idea what that is.
Very good show, actually. By the same guys who did...
Gurren Lagann.
Gurren Lagann, yeah. Cool. So that is our little for fun generation activity. So Hollywood producers, feel free to grab a copy of Genre and just have writers meetings where you just sort of keep drawing until you find something that just might work.
That's right. And make sure you're back at the $45 level. In fact, you may want to make sure that everyone at the table has a copy of the full set with dice.
Yes.
Meaning that you should take that 45 times the number of people on your team. Mm-hmm. That probably fund us right there, right?
Yeah.
It might, yeah.
Okay, we're
I mean,
good then.
Hollywood can just kind of, you know, keep it and have it prepared for when they run out of shows to remake. You know, television shows.
Exactly.
80s and 80s TV shows to make into movies and other older movies to make into more movies.
Well, I say that only half joking because I've actually, as we've been working on this and I've seen random combinations, I get like these little story ideas that pop in my head. It's like, I could make something out of that.
I'm not joking at all. Yeah. I never watched that, the pirate thing, man, that was
I think that one
a neat
would
idea.
Would work. I there is a show like that that is something called Black Sail or High Sails or something like that. That I've heard a little bit about that does seem kind of soap opery, but it doesn't have that extreme over-the-top element. It's just trying to go for a Game of Thrones on the high seas. Mm. sort of idea.
Yeah.
Which is why it didn't really appeal to me. It's just kind of like a low rent.
Mm-hmm.
So it's cash in on the like current theme of like dark historical style fiction.
So it's kind
of
like Vikings really. Then?
Yeah. Vikings, I'll say this. Vikings is actually really, really well done.
I've actually never seen it. But
I've got some history teacher friends who quit after the second episode.
Oh, it is not historically accurate.
Yeah.
However, it's in terms of dramatic storytelling, it's well done.
Oh, okay.
But do not watch it. I kind of like ran into that when I started watching it too. Like the first, right off the bat, the first episode, I was like, oh, this is so unrealistic. But
nice.
But it's it's not really. I don't think it's really going for that. Even it's extremely loosely based on an historical figure.
But it's based on the idea of this person we read about once.
Essentially, yeah.
Yeah.
Like very, very loosely based on this like legend of Ragnar, and then it just kept. And then it goes out of its way in like the second season to just completely break away from that.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess at that point, all the fans had looked it up on Wikipedia and known what the actual history was, so that they didn't want spoilers.
I'd probably be a bit disappointed in that show then, because about the time that I heard about it, I was playing Crusader Kings 2 with the Viking DLC. So you actually play as the Norse. Up there in Norseland.
In Norseland?
Norseland.
Yes, that's the place, no. But in all seriousness, it's a very in-depth sort of political and strategy simulation game. So you actually learn sort of through the game, not a ton, but you learn a lot about like kind of how the different cultures would work and that sort of thing. So it's actually kind of neat playing a Viking because it's so different from all the basically Christian European countries I'd played as before. Very different culturally, very different political structures, the way you sort of gain power and stuff like that's totally different. So really cool game.
Yeah,
I could talk at length about Crusader Kings.
I tried to get into Crusader Kings multiple times, and I honestly just couldn't. It just didn't suit me. Like
the learning curve is horrible.
It's not really that. I think it was just like I don't know all the different things. Because I've played some simulations before that I've enjoyed that have been, and they're all somewhat complicated.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I just the whole like politics and backstabbing part, like the whole political part was, which because it's so focused on politics.
Yeah,
and, like,
it's the bulk of the
marrying people, marrying off your heirs, and preparing to like kill someone in order to get them replaced in the throne, and like different. Yeah. I don't know. I've never really been a big fan of those sort of stories.
Mm-hmm. I just found it interesting because it was an interesting take on sort of this strategy, like medieval. Take over all these countries, the military force thing. You do that, but there's so much more behind the scenes too that it makes for emergent story. It's actually really awesome. But that is another discussion for another time.
You're here. Since I haven't played it, I have nothing to say about it. But it sounds cool.
Yeah, it's a really in-depth simulation, which has its ups and downs. Depends on what you're looking for in that sort of a game.
Yep. Yeah. Indeed.
Well, I know y'all are getting your Kickstarter started. Is it tomorrow when you're kicking this off?
Mm-hmm.
And so the plan is this podcast is going to go out tomorrow as well.
Yep.
So well, that
we're
going to
be posting it on the page. So for those of you who found the podcast through the page, hi.
Hello.
This is last night. And I'm going to be very tired by the time you're listening to this because I'm going to be up all night finishing preparations for the Kickstarter. So
now let me ask, this. when did y'all come up with the idea for genre? And how?
At this table, in fact.
Yeah. So I was telling Doc about a RPG that I was working on. It was essentially, the idea was that it was going to be a one-shot system where you can sort of plug in whatever scenario you want to use with it and just sort of play a one-session game. And somewhere on the sheet, I was thinking about having a thing where it would list the genres that you're playing the game in, and those genres might define certain elements of the game. For instance, if it's a it's an action scenario, you can expect to see a lot of action, whereas if it's a sort of like a personal drama sort of thing, you don't expect as much action, you're focusing more on the characters. It sort of gives the players a way to know what to expect. But while we were talking about that, Doc had this idea of what if there was an RPG where you can take different characters from entirely different genres of games and put them together and have them play like themselves, but still exist in the same world and still be playing the same game. And so we kind of ran with that idea, and we started off, and this is something we actually mentioned in the Kickstarter video, that it started off as a role-playing game, effectively, where everyone had their own mechanic, everyone had their own motivations, and everyone, like, we were not trying to make it so that everything sort of fit into one game. We were trying to make it so that everyone's kind of doing their own thing at the same
time. The cues and the mechanics were on cards, but it wasn't a card game in the traditional card game sense.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a way of organizing the information.
Yeah. And so then we took those cards and we tried to sort of play a little campaign at your church's Friday night game thing.
Family game night.
And we got some interesting responses. We got kind of the expected thing of it was kind of neat to see these weird genre crossovers and the scenario where we have like this weird mad scientist who's going up against like so-and-so's ninja and my, you know, space opera school days person and someone else, you know, with their own combination. So we got the quirky scenario generation thing down, I think. What we were lacking was we had the people who liked role-playing games, who liked storytelling. They were able mm-hmm. to sort of be flexible with the rules, which is what we intended. But then we had some people who wanted the rules to be very clear. They had a hard time just like grokking the game, if you will, because they mm-hmm. they thought that, okay, so how, what do I do in order to use an attack, or why can't I do this here, and that sort of thing. Because it was all basically up to GM discretion to say, you know, like, oh, you can use this here, you can't use this here, and there's a lot of sort of, you have to be creative to make something work.
Yeah, they were kind of frustrated with the conditional nature of some of the cards, mm-hmm. like if-then statements where the if never came up.
Yeah, exactly.
And so they literally just had a card or two cards, and they couldn't do anything.
Yeah. And so what we did is after that session, we sort of sat down, Doc and I, and for about an hour to sort of hash through some different ideas of how we could sort of make the game more coherent. And after about an hour, we sort of came up with this idea of the card game, where everyone has effectively the same things they can do, and then we might change slightly like what the mechanics are based on the genre. And then we actually hopped on Google Hangouts the next day, had a Google Doc open, we're just editing our spreadsheet, went through, added some new columns, we changed a bunch of stuff, and actually had another prototype ready that same afternoon after about, like, I guess it was maybe 6 or 8 hours
Just
straight editing.
But well, the great thing about it was we had a player who basically said, listen, I want to have a die mm-hmm. on every single card.
Yeah, because we didn't at one point.
Yeah, because our first draft wasn't... We didn't have a primary and a secondary mechanic. And mm-hmm. I think the very first thing you pointed out, Jim, when you looked at the card was, oh, look, there's a die type there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we didn't have that in the first draft. So you could almost argue that there were two different types of cards,
mm-hmm.
support cards and, you know, primary cards.
And the problem came up when you had someone who was just support.
Just cards. Support. Didn't want to play a support class, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
So then let me ask you this as a follow-up question to that. So why did you decide to mix it so that all cards had primary and support as opposed to just having people draw from two different decks?
Well, the main reason is that we wanted to make sure that everybody could play a primary ability or an attack, if you will,
mm-hmm.
from every single genre.
Okay, that makes sense.
And also have a secondary kind of flavor thing from every genre.
No, that makes perfect sense.
So the motivations are really what then key into whether or not that card is geared towards primary or secondary,
mm-hmm.
because the motivations can almost always pick.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't really talk much about the motivations, but I'll just draw one at random here. You had the extreme card at one point.
Mm-hmm.
That's the one that is in my hand. The motivation for extreme is pyromania. Use explosion, which is the secondary mechanic, to help deal at least double damage, which means you have to roll a 20+. And so explosion as a mechanic is an assist. Assists can only be used with a different card as a primary mechanic. And so if you had this card, you could help yourself, you could assist yourself, or you could assist me on my turn. And so let's say I'll pull another one at random here. I was rolling D6 for parity, Lampoon, mm-hmm. as the primary, and you said, wait, let me not just give you that Lampoon, but it'll be an explosive Lampoon, and I'm going to throw you an explosive charge here. And then you turn any roll into an explode mechanic. So you re-roll each die that lands on its max result and add it to the roll total and repeat until you stop rolling the max result. So that what that does is that turns my D6, which would be pretty ineffective against a D10, or I should say a difficulty of 10, into something that now has a 1 in 6 chance of exploding and then a 50-50 chance of actually succeeding beyond that 6 if I roll it. So those kind of emergent things, and that's just two cards I pulled at random. If you succeeded in doing that, then you'd hit your motivation, which was to use explosion to help deal double damage. And you could get XP if you managed to do that. So you might not want to help it on a D6, because that would be a bad strategy. But I think you get the point.
Well, let's talk about the different die, the D6 in particular, and seeing some of those D10s.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know Chris mentioned that the number that you're trying to reach is 10. Mm-hmm. Is that
right.
always the case?
The difficulty challenge is always 10.
So then the idea behind making it 10 and having a lot of cards with just D10 or sometimes even less,
mm-hmm.
Is because you are expecting people to use a lot of assists.
Yes.
Assist right. themselves and mm-hmm. also assist one another.
Right.
Try to sort of encourage that level of interplay.
That's mm-hmm. exactly right. In fact, the first round, you feel like a really small character. You feel like a level 1 character, if you will, to use mm-hmm. role-playing game terms. Somebody who's coming up against this baddie and you just barely beat him down, and you're hurting after that first session, or the first scene, I should say, which takes all of 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a bit like compressing roleplay down into, you know, your campaign for that night or your session for that night is down into a 5-minute scene. And it's a lot of fun
mm-hmm.
Having it that way, because then you can do a whole campaign in an hour
mm-hmm.
using these modified mechanics, simple mechanics, if you will. I think I completely dodged your actual question there, though.
Well, and I think the other point I was going to mention, too, mm-hmm. Usually the cards that have the dice that can't hit a 10 by themselves often make up for that with a easy motivation to hit, or with a really good secondary ability, kind of, you know, encouraging them to be support classes.
That's a really good point.
But also, we wanted to design it so that each genre, we didn't feel like we were sort of betraying the spirit of that genre by making all of them super powerful. Sometimes there's a genre where it's just like, doing a lot of damage doesn't make sense because that never happens in that genre. Let's see here. Machiavellian actually is very powerful, so that's not a good example.
That's one of my favorites, actually.
This one is a fun card. I'll get to this in a second. But, like, you know...
What do you want, like science?
Sure, science. So the primary mechanic for science, and this is one that actually... the experiment name is one that lends itself well to these sort of scenarios. So when you're trying to do your challenge... I'm experimenting to try to overcome that challenge,
mm-hmm.
Or I'm experimenting and somehow my experimentation is what's dealing damage to the nemesis, which you can go to some really weird places with that if you want to. But it's just a D6. So I would need somebody to assist my experiment in order for it to actually do anything significant. And actually the motivation on this card, scientific method, is to use experiment to complete a challenge condition. So essentially I'm trying to get someone else or to help myself in order to do this experiment to gain HP. On the other hand, I've got my secondary ability for science, which is an assist. I can add a D8 to any attack. I can basically help someone else with a D8, which is more powerful than D6. It's not, you know, going to be able to hit 10 by itself, but the idea is that it's a decent die I can add to someone else's roll. Now, science overall is only a level 1 card, and so sometimes we'll have cards that are just flat out weaker than others, just because it fit the nature of that card, but it also helps to balance the game out a little bit. Not every card's going to be super powerful, and that's actually intentional.
Okay. Good answer.
You could say the same thing for the mechanics, or the primary mechanic as well. Mm-hmm. We were very, very intentional with those.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, fantasy. Take mm-hmm. a guess what die type fantasy is.
D12?
Ooh, good guess. But think D&D.
Oh. D10? D6?
You don't play much D&D, do
you? D20.
Oh, I don't know why.
It's totally D20.
I don't know why that didn't, click. I was like, what?
Yeah, don't worry.
Because I wanted to put you on the spot.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, obviously...
Need more coffee.
There's never been a D&D that didn't use D20, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we had to use D20 for mm-hmm. the fantasy card. But... on the flip side, you know, we've got a card in there that's noir, as in Detective Noir,
mm-hmm.
not to be confused with the Detective card, which is a different card.
Mm-hmm.
But there's actually one of my favorite systems called Mean Streets, mm-hmm. which is to roll 2d6. And so that's the mechanic that we used for noir. Because if you look at the dice math behind mm-hmm. What's going on there, when you roll, say... let's go with a D12, because 6 plus 6 is 12, right? That's exactly the same. 2D6 and a D12, that's the same, right?
Not the same.
No,
it's not the same.
Totally not the same. Because one is a linear curve, and the other is...
a bell curve.
It's a bell curve.
Yeah.
And so the 2D6 is the bell curve, by the way, anytime you roll two dice. This is why anybody who says that rolling 2D10s is the same as rolling a D100, technically no.
Mm.
But... What it comes down to is, you know, if you go to Vegas and you're rolling 2d6, right, the most common thing you're going to roll is a 7. That's why the house always wins on the craps table. It's because they know the most common thing is going to be that 7 that comes up. Mm-hmm. So what we tried to do then was to work in those bell curves, like an extremely average number of a 7 is going to come up most commonly on that 2d6. We use that mechanic, just like it's used in that Mean Streets example for the noir card. So we were very, very intentional about all the things that we're doing.
And I mentioned earlier, too, that we intended to make certain cards weak, and it's not right. just for sort of flavor reasons.
Yeah, like Buddy.
It's also, yeah. it's also because when you give cards to the GM, you can kind of control the power of the GM by controlling the power of the cards you give him. So you can give him, or her, weak cards, level 1 cards. And they're not going to be able to do too much damage to you. It's kind of a good, safe way to go. But the trade-off is that you only get level 1 challenges from that, which means that you only can gain 1 experience from completing the challenge of that scene. And when the name of the game, ultimately your goal is to save up enough XP to buy a Deus Ex Machina, which then ends the story and wins the game for the players. When you're trying to save up XP before the deck runs out, it actually behooves you to give the GM more powerful cards so that you can get more experience per scene. That also means that the nemesis is going to be more challenging. So it's kind of this interesting balancing act you have to do between going for the win while also not letting the GM get too powerful.
So essentially, let's talk about that, the cooperative nature of the game.
Mm-hmm.
Am I correct in my assumption that, mm-hmm. and I believe you talked about it some, that there's the GM mm-hmm. versus all of the players
That's
in conjunction?
Correct. Yes.
Yeah.
And there is no, like, either players win or GM wins, essentially?
Yeah, it's just like any role-playing game, really.
Well, so the GM doesn't win then?
No, actually it is, unlike role-playing games in that sense.
But yeah, there is a win condition. Yeah. That's a good point.
The players win or the GM wins, but the GM's job is also, like, the GM should not feel bad if they lose, because they're also there to help tell the story, to help kind of be the leader of the story. They're the ones who are sort of describing what's happening. They're the ones who are describing what the nemesis is doing. But at the same time, they are trying to win. They're trying to beat the players.
Mm-hmm. Maybe dungeon crawl board game would be a better example.
Yeah.
Like Descent.
Like
or
Descent.
Doom. Or mm-hmm. The Star Wars one that just came out. Imperial Assault. Right? There's a dungeon master and then there's everybody else. Everybody else is on the team. They can decide which order they want to go in. And this is the mechanic that we used. I mean, we intentionally made it feel that way so that you can strategize and you can make it what you want it to be.
Okay.
So I could completely see this in the wrong crowd. So that would just like with any other game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're like, what do we do? I don't know. What do we do? I don't know. Mm-hmm. But if you've got a really great crowd of gamers, like those of us who game regularly do, it's the most intense and awesome thing that you'll ever see, because it's exactly that perfect scenario for cooperation mm-hmm. in that context.
So do you think the best relationship in for genre mm-hmm. is for the GM and for the players to ultimately have the same goal of having a compelling storytelling experience, role-playing experience?
I think that's entirely up to the crowd.
Yeah, definitely.
However, I would strongly encourage people to play it at least once in such mm-hmm. a way where the GM is just out to get you. Mm-hmm. Because I think that challenge that makes it more fun whenever you really...
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we've tested this one... Gosh, I don't even know how many times now.
You've tested it more than I have.
Played and played. And I cannot tell you how many times it has been a close game, like a super close game, almost every single time. Mm. And that's because we mathematically balanced the deck with the 30 cards so that it would be almost every time a 5-scene game.
Mm-hmm. Like the 5-act structure of a play.
Yeah, 5-act structure of a play. And that was, again, by design.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we've played a lot of role-playing games, a lot of indie systems, a lot of stuff. We've got a big old shelf of games at home, and it's one of those things where we wanted to take the best of what we love and really make sure that stuff showed up.
Mm. Okay.
So, I think for us, I'm not a big fan of GMs who try to kill you in a tabletop role-playing scenario.
Mm.
But I think for this game, because it's an hour...
Mm. And because it's a card game.
And because it's a card game, that's the right place to do it.
Mm.
Just like in, say, Descent and Doom. And
right.
It's just not... It's not about the story mm-hmm. on those. You're playing a board game.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, you know, that's one of the criticisms of 4th edition. We can talk about that now because, you know, 5th is out and it fixed everything, right? but a lot of people said it's just a board game. Fourth ed D&D is just a board game. And I saw that criticism. I understood it.
Well, they specifically made board games with 4th edition rules.
They did.
Yep.
Yeah,
to try to make it have a similar sort of experience.
Yeah, they actually wanted the minis game to be completely compatible with the rest of it, and they mm-hmm. succeeded wildly. And ironically, people didn't respond well to it. At least
older generation. It's a really cool concept, I think, to be able to take your campaign character and stick them into this board game where typically you're just given a character. I think that's really cool, but I mean, at least my own personal taste, I'm more a story role player than I am a, you know, tactical, like, let's do 2 hours worth of combat every night.
Not a heavy fizz repper whenever we role play.
So, and, you know, I think that actually genre is one of the most mechanically focused games I've designed in a while, because typically when I'm designing role-playing games, I like to let the rules be as light as possible so the focus is on the story. In fact, when I put in rules, I try to make the rules about how the story's kind of steered, how your characters are steered.
That's right.
But this thing here, you can actually play it totally ignoring the story if you want. You can treat it purely as a strategy game. And so I think that's interesting in that regard, too. They can kind of be played by very different types of players, not just, you know, the GM who's trying to sort of, like, you know, take it easy on the players to make an interesting story. Because I think the story in this game is more... almost a side effect of the mechanics than it is the primary thing with the mechanics kind of aiding it, if that makes sense.
So let me ask you some about the role-playing nature mm-hmm. of the game itself
mm-hmm.
and the different sort of cards or sort of character that you might be playing based mm-hmm. on the cards that you have. Is there more of a focus, or do you think that there should be more of a focus from those that are playing the game on trying to roleplay their character, or trying to do whatever it takes to get the best mechanical advantage to win?
I'd say,
kind of see the difference there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do see the difference. Yeah. I'd say the latter. I think ultimately, and especially after you've played one or two games, it does become about how do we strategize the best in order to try to win the game. But that being said, I think we've designed the cards in such a way where the mechanics that you're using kind of tell a story themselves. Even just naming the move that you're using kind of introduces these interesting little moments where even if you're not thinking about it, other people can kind of comment or find it funny or something like that, that I'm, you know, attacking someone with a bro fist mm-hmm. if I'm using the buddy card, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'm using force science to help my Machiavellian friend backstab someone. Which
that makes sense.
I mentioned too that I was going to get to this card. I just want to sidetrack us for a second here. The secondary ability here, the end justifies the means. With or without permission, you can spend 1 XP from another player, because everyone has their own XP pools. You can't spend your own, to deal 2 unblockable damage to a single opponent. And then basically the motivation is, results speak for themselves, use the end justifies the means to deal the final blow to a nemesis. So basically, you're stealing someone else's hard-earned XP to deal 2 damage, so it's really powerful. It's like, hey, the end does justify the means, but the question is, do the other players feel the same way? So it's an interesting Machiavellian. You have to actually justify yourself to the other players while you're playing the game. And so it's another example of how the genre's card kind of brings out that genre in your play experience.
Mm-hmm.
So
players, all since they have their own separate XP pools, they level mm-hmm. up at a different individual rate.
It's not so much the level up as you use your experience to buy new cards. So at each scene change, there's a set of cards that's laid out on the table. It's always there. As soon as someone spends an experience to buy a new card to add to their character, you just refill it with another card from the deck.
Mm.
And so everyone is able to basically, you'll earn experience at different rates typically, because you'll have some people who are really good at fulfilling motivations while others are more focused on dealing damage and that sort of thing. But you'll buy new cards, and so people who are earning more experience more quickly can afford to buy more cards, but they're also the ones who tend to save in order to help the group save up their total amount for the win. So actually, you'll tend to have a little bit of variance between players, but not a ton. I think what tends to happen is you'll have a few players that have like 4 cards, and then a couple others that are sort of just skimming by on 1 or 2 or maybe 3. But generally, you're not going to like have like 20 cards in front of you by the end of the game. In fact, you couldn't.
Yeah, it's
so
true.
So you all talked a lot about the scenes, and I want to make sure that, I understand this and that listeners understand it too. So the scenes are essentially individual encounters.
Yes.
Kind of. And how long do the scenes last? You mentioned that a session is normally about five scenes.
Yes.
So how long do scenes, does it take to go through a scene?
5-10 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Generally.
So this is meant to be a potentially a relatively short campaign.
Okay. Correct. Yeah. Yeah. It's totally like just a one-shot weird story. Yeah.
We do have campaign rules, which are kind of fun because basically when the deck is out, you just keep going.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea behind it is, yeah, this is a temporary problem, five scenes. And one of the real challenges, and I say that in a good way, is for the GM to be able to tie in everything. Because suddenly you find yourself in a suburb, and then in the next scene you're in a birthday party for some reason.
It actually kind of fit, but it actually says
it says birthday party for some reason.
Yes, exactly.
That's the fanfiction card.
Yeah.
And then after that, you find yourself in counterculture. The birthday party just went terribly wrong, I guess. And then after that, you find yourself in a dream or reality you can't tell. That's the surreal
part. You see, what's funny is like this
is working.
I'm actually
quite well.
Yeah.
That's why it went counterculture. Yeah. It is a dream.
And then the past, present, and or future. And so sometimes.
And you're not sure because it's a dream, because you never really know when a dream is taking
there you
place.
Go. So maybe that was... We've over-designed this game.
Yeah.
Because I was trying to do something that didn't work.
And yeah.
That was perfect.
I think any GM, though, can make anything work. So.
Well, and I guess that's the point, isn't it? You know, my favorite is whenever you know that post-apocalyptic card is coming up, and so you're like, come on, give it to me, give it to me, give it to me, give it to me, and then, you know, you find out that the whole thing was an illusion this whole time, and you know, the holodeck goes into digital fuzz, and then you step out of the room and oh my goodness, we're in the post-apocalypse, or that kind of a moment where the big scene change switches around scene three or so. I love being able to do that.
And so to sort of put a cap on the whole scene idea too, what you do is for each scene the GM will generate one nemesis, and then each player, counting the GM, gets to exhaust one card per turn. And so essentially all the players get to go in whatever order they want, and then the GM goes, if they have more than one nemesis, they can use each nemesis, or each nemesis can do one action, and then you go back to the other players, or to the other side, and they get to exhaust another card to use another ability. So it's essentially like each person does one thing, and then you sort of repeat, and once all the cards are exhausted, then the scene ends. If by the end of the scene the nemesis is still alive, then the nemesis actually survives with whatever health they have left to join whatever the next nemesis is in the new scene.
Yeah, and if you don't hit the challenge condition, you can heal the nemesis up too, which is
super
cool.
So speaking of the nemesis, the nemesis works with the GM, but the nemesis is related in some way to each player or to an individual player?
Not necessarily, although that being said...
I mean from a genre sense.
Right, from a genre sense.
Not from a familial sense.
Yes. From the second scene on, actually, there's the possibility that the cards that the players handed the GM could be a card that they were using before. So you can either choose to essentially buy a card to give to the GM, or you can buy a new card and just give away one of your old ones. So it's possible, for instance, that I had a pirate ninja in my first scene, and then I drew out... let's say tragedy. So now I want to play my ninja tragedy, I give you my pirate, and then when you generate your nemesis, pirate's in the nemesis, and so somehow it could be related to my character, because we have that pirate connection. It doesn't always work out that way, but sometimes it does.
A lot of times it does.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, especially when mecha is given away, then it's like, oh, he's in my old mecha suit.
Yeah,
no, he's
not.
I mean, but it kind of feels that way.
So it's GM discretion.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, totally.
For me, this is just personal technique, but what I like to do is look at the second card that comes out and generate the nemesis based on that second card. So, for example, if it was mecha vampire action, right, which would be a futuristic castle where you have to defeat a bunch of goons, defuse the bomb, and rescue the hostages, I would look at that second card, which was vampire, and say, what kind of castle is it? Oh, it's a vampire castle. Okay. So you're up in a castle that has a vampire in it, and so that nemesis is literally the vampire.
Also, I think you just described one of the newer Castlevania games.
Did I?
Oh, you might have.
Fantastic. Action mecha vampire?
Mecha maybe not so much.
Oh.
But, the futuristic, though, is the setting is kind of what made me think that.
Oh, I see. Yeah, that makes sense.
I think the like one of the newest Castlevania games, there's kind of like this time warp thing where you sort of like play in the past and play in like the near future. But anyway.
There are a lot of like mechanical beasts, mechanical, like, you know, villains inside some of the Castlevania games as well.
Oh, cool.
So, like, moving armors and, like, older style robots, like, kind of trying to fit into, like, the
automated traps and stuff.
Yeah, that kind of thing. So,
that makes sense.
It sort of works.
But we already established what a vampire mecha was anyway earlier. Yeah. So, clearly, that's what.
the drain attack, yes.
Yeah. But to me, that's the most fun part of being the GM. And I love being a player too, because then, you know, as we had described, you try to figure out how all that stuff ties in together and your character's constantly evolving. But I have this terrible habit as a player, and that's to forget to buy the GM a card, and I end up having to give away one of my good cards because I keep spending them on good things. I got the super powerful character, and then, oh wait, I have to give one of my cards away. But there's a strategy behind which card you give the GM. You can give a level 1 or a level 2 or a level 3 challenge. And if you give the level 1 challenge, then you're going to be able to beat him pretty easily. He's probably not going to have a very strong nemesis to bring against you, assuming everyone has given level 1s. But you're also only going to get 1 XP for everybody whenever you beat that challenge. So if you give away those 3s, you've got a nastier nemesis and a harder challenge, but everybody's going to get, you know, 3. And if you're playing a 6-player game, that's 5 times 3. It's 15 XP for everybody. Boom, you know. So
essentially, the players are setting their own difficulty.
Yeah.
Yes. And actually, that became a balancing problem in one of the earlier versions of the prototype that we did. So what started to happen is after a few games, we had the same group of players who just really loved the game and wanted to play it over and over and over again every afternoon. And they started to get really good at knowing which cards to give to the GM and which ones not to give. And they would give him cards that like literally could never roll 10s. And so they just started steamrolling them. So what we ended up having to do is finding some way. It's like, okay, how can we make it so the GM has more options or is more powerful, better balanced?
Scarier.
And
wanted him to be scarier.
What we landed on was giving them the ability to roll a 1 on any die.
Yeah.
And that 1 becomes an unblockable critical hit. And that can also be added to the rest of your dice, which then if you get, like, you know, a total of 10 or 20 or whatever, you add that 1 or 2 damage to your extra critical damage. So, for instance, if I rolled an 11 and it was a 10 and a 1, I would actually deal 2 damage because of the 1 plus the 11 being greater than 10.
Or even if it was a 9 and a 1, because it adds up to 10, and it's still got the 1.
But what it means, essentially, is that what used to be a super weak card for the GM, a D2 or a D4 or something like that, all of a sudden you got a 50% chance to deal damage, a 25% chance to deal damage.
Yeah, I was about to say, that I totally see why you do that, because of that, for that reason.
And it works thematically, too, because those cards tend to be the ones like Buddy, for example, is a D2.
Or Geek is a really low one, too.
Yeah, so if you, you know, if you make it so that you've got this, you know, this bad guy who's a geek, man, never take off a geek. Don't betray your buddy, you know, because they're going to come back at you, and it's going to hurt.
And it's the idea, too, that, like, you know, it's the, again, you know, sort of the same thing you just said, is that this weak character, as long as they're not the bad guy, is weak, but then all of a sudden they become the bad guy, and being the bad guy, you know, it's no holds barred. We can go on and on about, like, kind of the thematic, you know, when you're writing a villain, what it is that makes them so scary. But that's kind of, it translates very nicely into what happens in genre when you have a weak card for a player turn into a very powerful card for the GM.
Yep.
Cool. Well, I think I've actually learned quite a bit about the game from more from discussions than from the initial attempt to kind of read it and play. That was a good introduction, though.
Yeah. Well, we weren't really trying to play during that introduction, too. It was more kind of just like a fun little let's
an exercise scene. With the So, the scene generation, you mentioned that was sort of the original idea, the original genesis. Is that something that you think people could still use to play, maybe in terms of like a role-playing session?
For sure.
To sort of use the cards specifically just to build a scene or come up with scene ideas?
Yeah. We wanted to preserve that, because that was the original seed of the idea, and it's still there.
Now, have you all played an RPG? Have you played one using the the cards, the genre cards, to build a scene?
Not yet, but I think that's in our very near future.
Oh, yeah. Something you plan to do pretty soon, essentially. Yes. Cool.
Especially, and yeah, this is actually a decent chance to talk briefly about a plan for Backward Compatible, more so than for, you know, Doc and Krieger and genre. We were thinking about doing a show where we'd live stream us role-playing.
Right. And we've been talking about that for a while.
Yeah. And we're still working on the logistics of how we're actually going to get that to happen. But the thought we had is that we'd play, like, you know, one-shot scenarios or, like, you know, short campaigns, like, you know, 2 to 3 sessions, that sort of thing. Maybe if we want to get crazy, go up to 5 or something like that. But, you know, something where you can sort of sit down with an episode of our stream, either watching it live or watching it recorded, and sort of get a complete game experience. And generating something with genre is something that we could totally do on that show. You know, come up with just like a quirky little scenario, use a generic system, and just sort of roll with it for an evening. So,
yeah.
I like that. Is that ROLE or ROLL?
Both.
Oh, okay.
So,
I like that. And that's something else that's coming from Backward Compatible. Mm-hmm. And I think we're getting a little bit closer to where we should probably start wrapping up,
probably.
I would say,
yeah.
And I think a good way to wrap up is just to sort of mention, I don't think we've mentioned it on the podcast, that our site is still sort of kind of in limbo, work in progress. We had some issues with migrating to a different server, or a different domain, rather. And the way that we're going to sort of, you know, resurrect and reboot might not be exactly with the same content. That's something that we're still trying to figure out, but we do know that the podcast will continue.
Yes.
And we will have other content that we're going to be carrying forward with. And this time it will be with Dr. Brackin, so who's joining us officially as of today.
Yep.
And I think,
I'd like to thank all the little people who made this possible. my cat, my 8-month-old. that's...
The little people.
The little people.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Darby O'Gill.
Well, sure.
That's way too obscure. Too obscure.
too obscure, yeah.
Yeah, and like you said, Jim, we're still trying to settle on exactly what the new direction is going to look like for Backward Compatible, but I know we've discussed to some extent that essentially the general idea is that the podcast and other sort of like video and audio content is going to be kind of the driving thing, and then any we're not going to do like the long form articles we used to. We might occasionally do the roundtables, but
we're not going to. I think we're moving we're shifting focus away somewhat from the written material.
Mm-hmm.
At least the longer written material, and having it more integrate with the audio and video content. Yeah. And there's a lot of cool things we can do with audio and video that I think we can explore.
Yep.
Aside from just doing written articles, which I think
more supplementary material for our main content, and then you know occasionally the roundtables, but not so much the. We started off with the crazy idea that we were each going to do a feature every 3 weeks. I think that, and this is something Richard's actually commented too outside of Backward Compatible, but that there tends to be a movement away from the older form of written material and a movement toward, you know, video and live streaming and stuff like that, and gaming journalism as well as, you know, journalism in general, because and one of his observations was that it tends to be more about now personalities than it is about kind of in-depth reporting, which that's again another discussion that could go on for quite a while, but it's an interesting trend that we're seeing right
sounds
now
like the topic for the next podcast,
maybe.
Yeah, I think we're getting a little too meta.
Yeah.
But I would like to close us out just you know another quick reminder about y'all's Kickstarter that will be starting in conjunction with when this podcast goes out. Do you have a link yet?
Not yet, because we actually have to hit publish before we get the final link. Okay. Like, there are, like, temp links that we could use, but then it would change, so we don't really want to get it.
Well, the one link that's consistent is docandkruger.com/genre.
There you go. Thank you.
Because that's going to link to wherever.
Yep.
And what you can do as well when you're editing this is you can just, where I say, do you have a link for the Kickstarter, you can edit the Kickstarter information.
Have, like, the little robotic computer voice read it out.
Do you have a link? And then it's like... You know, everything
pauses. www.kickstarter.com
/.
Oh, speaking of
W-V- capital X. No.
Yeah, I was coming up here using my my iPhone to sort of direct me with Google Maps, and it was giving me directions, and it was kept telling me to get off on 75 North towards MC Kenny.
MC Kenny.
Yeah. Like, MC Kenny. Oh, yeah, that's MC
cool.
Kenny. Great.
I like the way Siri says Mockingbird as well.
Mockingbird.
Mockingbird.
Mockingbird. All right, well, I think that just about wraps us on another Backward Compatible podcast. What, number 24?
24.
That must be the end because the music's playing. So.
Rolling us out. Okay, well, good luck on the Kickstarter.
Thank you.
And we'll see how it goes. And I think, how long are y'all planning to have it run?
30 days.
30 days. Yep. Okay.
Well, I'm Chris.
And I'm Doug.
And I'm Jim.
And we'll see you guys next time.
Bye.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, what are your favorite genres of fiction, and what's the craziest mashup you can think of? Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.